Well, hello once again. This is going to be part two of episode two of Surviving Life. Did you get that? I hope that you got a chance to see the last one, because if you didn't, you're going to miss a whole bunch of heaven. Or at least one.
Oh, that was pretty good, being a subject of seven.
I come up with these little things. Yeah.
You do. I like that.
Kidneys.
Your kidneys are up here?
Well, mine are. I'm not sure about yours. We have fun on this program. This is Surviving Life. I'm Gary Dean.
And I'm supposed to say
that. This is your cue.
Oh, this is my cue.
Yeah.
I'm Joe Judkins. Pleased to meet you, folks. Glad you're tuning in to listen to us two old guys just praising the Lord.
This is us old guys stuff. My brain is still my brain is still about 12.
I'm glad you corrected yourself before I jumped on that.
The mind has a way of not catching up with the body until it spends more than a half hour in the mirror every morning.
Yeah.
Because inside I'm still 30, but outside I'm 70. And sometimes that's a hard reality for people.
I look in the mirror because I really think I'm really young because I feel so good.
Me too. Well,
and then I go in the bathroom, to do my shaving or whatever. Oh, I got a wrinkle. Oh, there's another wrinkle. Oh, my.
I have a wrinkle.
Look at all these wrinkles I'm developing. But, praise the Lord. We're here for another
if
day.
If this were heaven, we'd still be 30 years old. If God intended us to stay young forever, this would already be heaven. And the heaven, the way I remember it, and the way I'm taught, is there was one. And we talked about this the last time. I want to be that top of the genetic equation when the genes tell you that at 30 you're at the peak of your life. That area there, because and that's the way the genetic makeup is of people. Is around 30 years old. Then you start declining and getting older as you go down. So you get to 30 and then it's 40. 50,
that hasn't 60, happened 70. With me.
No.
Now my face may say
that's
so,
it.
But the rest of me is still climbing that mountain.
Sure.
Look where we are right now. Look what we're doing right now.
Mm.
You was in television, and then you got out of it for various reasons.
Mm-hmm.
And then you went into radio, and now you're out of that, and now you are on the internet, available worldwide. Before on television, you were Eastern North Carolina, but now you're on the internet, available for anybody in the world to see you.
Look, I did make national television.
Well, you made national, true.
Now the thing is that I made national television by being a cashier.
Okay.
Food Lion.
Yeah. Oh, that's right.
And that's the last chapter of my
book. That was last year.
Story.
Yeah, last year.
The last chapter is titled From Food Lion to Fox and Friends. But and that's another story. You'll have to read my book to get the gist of that. But the reason I wanted to bring up how age and our mind are different. We see ourselves on the inside as young at heart.
Yeah, yeah.
But the world sees us on the outside as two old guys sitting here, and what are they going to be talking about? Well, the reason I wanted to add the word heaven is last week you talked about something called the first heaven, and this is the first heaven.
That we're in right now.
Right. Well, heaven to me is ageless. I'm old, so this can't be the final heaven.
Well, no, because God's going to do a major change to first heaven.
That's where we left off.
No, this is in the tribulation period.
Oh, okay.
When he drops the hammer on the world,
sure.
Those who reject him.
Right.
Yeah, but that's revelation. We're not going in that direction yet.
Now, don't get me confused now.
Yeah, yeah.
Three heavens, you said.
Three heavens.
All right. You mentioned the first heaven, this being the first heaven.
We are in the first heaven.
How do we get to the second heaven?
Well, let me explain second heaven first.
Please do.
Before we go into your question. All right. So, again, I'm going to be reading. I am meticulous in trying to write words that are proper. Because, as you know, and as you related last week, it was a point in time just a few years ago, I couldn't even put two words together.
Mm-hmm.
I had a terrible time in my
my learning process and all like that. But God has blessed me now.
Sure.
And so I really take my gift of writing very seriously.
Word for word.
Yeah. Okay, so I'm going to read the second part, which is Second Heaven.
Now, tell me from what book that is.
This, well, it's in...
You can get these books.
It's in all my books.
Right, but this book in particular.
Help Me, Jesus, Thank You. Help Me, Jesus, Thank You. And I've also got a book, Help Me, Jesus, Help Me. Help Me, Jesus, Help Me. I've got several books that are the same text, but different titles.
So you can put them all together and make a song.
I tell you what, let's do that. So it's the opening pages of all my books are the same.
Sure.
Okay. Except my book on fasting and my book on God putting us down in the valley and burning all the impurities off of us before He raised us back up.
Uh-huh.
So, reading the Second Heaven now. This is going to be a shocker to a lot of people.
Me included.
Okay. It was to me too when He revealed it to me. Now, talking about Jesus, then you continued, you know, when He ascended on the 40th day in front of over 500 people,
right.
Then you continued your ascension through the second heaven, which is like a gathering place. Now, please notice my words, like a gathering place. I'm not saying it is a gathering place, but follow my words, which is like a gathering place for principalities, powers, rulers of darkness, spiritual wickedness, devils and demons who are preparing their attacks against humankind. However, when they saw you ascending through their occupied space and realized that they had to bend their knee and bow before you, the Lamb of God, the Redeemer, the Savior of the world, the Messiah, the Son of God, Jesus Christ, because of your finished work on the cross. So, the second heaven, I look at it as the heaven of separation. It is the separation between the first heaven and the third heaven, which is the kingdom of heaven. So the second heaven, I see it as the heaven of separation. And I see it where it's an hostile environment. Mm-hmm. Second heaven, because we can't just go up there without space suits and air packs and all and survive. It's hostile. And so I look at hostile being demonic in this particular passage of writing.
Uh-huh.
So I look at principalities and powers and rulers of darkness, spiritual wickedness, devils and demons, being in a hostile environment, preparing for more attacks against us. But when Jesus was ascending up through the second heaven, they realized then that He had completed His finished work on the cross, and they had to take a knee, and they had to bow, because they realized that He is the Son of God. He completed the mission that God sent Him here for, was to redeem souls. There is a denomination that says because Jesus died on the cross for the sins of the world, everybody is saved. You don't have to worry about your lifestyle and what you do. Everybody's saved.
Well, the Bible says we have to hold accountability.
Well, they only look at parts of the Bible.
Okay.
And it's just like Jesus on His cross, there was a feller on His cross who mocked Jesus.
Right.
And then there was another feller who said, we deserve death for what we have done.
This man has done nothing.
He said three things that is the plan of salvation. He said, first, we deserve death. He acknowledges his sinful life. The second thing he said was, Lord.
Yeah.
He recognized Jesus Christ as God, as Lord. And then the third thing he said, remember me. Absolutely. Remember. That's all he said. And Jesus, what did he say? Today, you will be with me in paradise. The simple plan of salvation.
Right.
So, That right there.
So clever, isn't it?
That nullifies all of that other stuff.
Sure.
When I had my first World Crusade, I had a box about like this, wrapped up, had a bow on it.
Yeah.
And I was explaining how that box was the gift of salvation.
Right.
I unwrapped it, and I had bought a gold sweater and put in there. I took out the gold sweater. I said, wow, the gold sweater of salvation. I've got to put this on. And I would put it on. I said, wow, this is wonderful. The gold sweater of salvation. I've got to go tell people about this. I've got to show them salvation. So I was using that as an example of what salvation from Jesus is all about.
Yeah.
We got to put it on. We got to show it.
Yeah.
You can't run over to the corner and just leave your box all wrapped up and not open it. You've got to open up the box of salvation. You put it on and tell people about it.
On top of that, put on that full armor.
The full armor. Absolutely.
Yeah. Okay, but again, we're talking past tense. That is the second heaven was an experienced position for Jesus Christ. But when people die here, when they transition from this mortal coil to their heavenly body, you hear people always say, well, he's gone on to be with the Lord. He's back with his mama in heaven. He's gone on to be with the angels. He's now an angel. Of course, we don't become angels.
No,
there's
we
a
don't.
Big separation
we don't.
There. But you know, people kind of take the Bible literally, and then I don't know the words I'm looking for on that one, but they use those words and transform those words into something that's almost fantasy.
Well, a lot of people are talking that way, and people are picking up on it because it sounds nice.
Yeah, but that's not what happens.
You've got to read the Bible word for word to see what it says. If you've got a pastor at a church who preaches what the Bible says,
yeah,
you better hold on to that person.
Yeah.
Man or woman, I'm not going to go any further than that. Whoever your pastor is, if they preach what the Bible is saying, you better hold on to that person.
Yeah.
And so the second heaven there is space. So you shoot somebody up in a rocket, they're up in the second heaven. We always say space.
Huh?
But where do they go? They go up into
the second. Now we're getting to the point.
Now we're getting to the point, aren't we? The second heaven is space. We look up there. We see the moon, the sun. We see the other planets.
Billions and billions of stars.
Stars. Yeah. Oh, my goodness, the stars and shooting stars and meteors, galaxies, Milky Way. Now, how God made the earth way over here and then expanded this universe, I don't know. But that brings up a good question. I've heard a lot of people say when they get to heaven, they're going to ask Jesus, how did this, how did that?
Yeah, many questions.
Oh, so many questions. Yes. But then I got thinking about one day, and I was thinking to myself, are we really going to ask how?
We're going to know, actually.
Or are we going to be so hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah,
praise God.
So into such a praise mode that we don't care how he did it, but that we are there.
I think it's going to be more of a revelation of, oh, now I get it. I think we're going to have knowledge that we do not have here. And something else that I always wondered about, you're always hearing about these UFO tapes and these sightings, and we've seen the aliens here, and we've seen them here, and then Elvis is over here. But you see all these videos about evidence of aliens, but you never really have true evidence. They're just foggy little images of saucers flying. You hear about that and you see those. But it boggles the mind that if we have all these videos here, why hasn't the Hubble telescope that reaches into novas from billions and billions of light years away ever picked up an image of the Starship Enterprise or anything else that might be considered.
But William Shatner's still here.
He did grow up a little bit.
Yeah, he did. Didn't
but
he?
You never see that from anything that shows that second heaven. This kind of debunks a little bit of the alien philosophy.
And it's a hostile environment.
Yeah.
And so I can't answer those questions.
Sure.
Am I interested in it? No.
Really?
No. I mean, it's interesting to hear.
Sure.
It's interesting to hear it and what people say. But am I going to search it out?
Yeah.
No.
All right.
If I hear it, fine.
Okay.
But I focus on Christ Jesus.
Absolutely.
That's what I am so intense on. So it's really space to man, but it's the second heaven.
Okay.
To the Bible and what God.
Well, how do you get past that to what everybody wants to achieve?
Resurrection. Now, think about this. Enoch in Genesis did not die. The Lord called him up. He was a man on earth breathing oxygen.
Mm-hmm.
The Lord called him up. So he had to translate from the first heaven through the second heaven. He's a man. He breathes oxygen into the third heaven.
So how did you get between here and there?
Well, that might be one of the questions we're going to ask the Lord.
Okay.
How'd you do this, Lord? And then Elijah. He was another.
Right.
He translated
to taste death.
Through the first heaven, through the second heaven, into the third heaven.
I see.
And so some people think that they will be the two witnesses that come back in the book of Revelation.
Yes.
But we'll that's another program.
Okay.
That's another.
But some philosophers think you're going into as the opening of the show said, you're about to enter a new dimension.
Mm-hmm.
Are we going interdimensionally into the third heaven, or are we just going up?
The translation, it seems, from what the Bible is inferring, on that subject, it's going to be the twinkling of an eye. It's going to be so quick that we're not going to realize it. We're not going to be looking at stars.
It's not going to be one of them journeys.
No, it's not going to be one of those nice, calm, cruising journeys. Yeah. It's going to be so fast to get up into the third heaven.
Okay.
Okay. So
what is
space
the third?
Space is the second heaven.
What is the third heaven?
Okay. The third heaven is the kingdom of God.
Okay.
And
that's what I'm looking forward to.
Let me read the third.
Okay.
Then you continued your ascension into the third heaven, the residence of the highest God, Father God, and His most high and holy heavenly host. You sat at His right hand, meaning you returned to fellowshipping with the Father, and you are counselor and advocate for all the saints, that is, the true blood of Jesus, born again, proclaiming faith believers. Now, the right hand of fellowship. You've heard that expression before.
Yeah.
So it's very important for us to understand that Jesus sits at the right hand of God, which means He has returned to fellowshipping with the Father, because He always was. As John writes in John 1:1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Okay? So Jesus has returned to fellowshipping with the Father and to be our advocate. Now here's something else. And this, what I'm going to say right now, is it puts a smile on my face.
Sure.
People go through hard times and they call out, Jesus, help me, Jesus, help me. They claim Jesus as a Lord and Savior. And even though they're going through a hard time, Jesus is advocating for you if you're going through a hard time, whatever you go through. And Jesus says, Satan, she is mine. Or Jesus says, Satan, he is mine. You cannot have them. Whatever you go through, because the Lord lets you know that He had you.
Mm-hmm.
If you read this book right here, oh, this book is powerful, folks. you read this book right here, the Lord had you all through the stuff that you went through.
And so many times I did not know that.
And Jesus was beside God saying, Satan, Gary is mine. You cannot have him.
Yeah.
Oh, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord to that. I tell you what.
Wow.
So,
does make you smile.
Doesn't it, though?
Yes, it does.
Oh, my goodness. And I thought of something else. Let me say something
sure.
else here.
You have 30 seconds.
Okay. Hey, get away from the
no,
TV
sorry.
Screen. It's habit, man.
Yeah, it certainly is. Always watching the clock.
Every one of us smear our testimony. Constantly, we do something or we say something that puts a smear on our testimony.
Hmm.
And I've got so many t-shirts where I have smeared my testimony. Living life is hard to do the way things are right now. The way Satan tries to deceive everybody and take people down different roads, and it's so hard for us to grab a hold of the right way back to the highway that leads to the cross of Jesus. We just get off track sometimes, and we may smear our testimony. But let me tell you, folks, pray to Jesus Christ and let him know that you're sorry, that you smeared your testimony, and I'm sorry, I'm back on track. Thank you for being with me, Jesus. And take this smear away. And the moment you confess of it, it's gone. You don't have a trail of smears that you're dragging behind you. They're all gone.
Mm-hmm.
And when I preached one Sunday, I said, you're walking around with a TV screen behind you. It's going to show your past life. TV screens will show your past life. And what's on the TV screen is blank because Jesus has forgiven you. There's nothing there for anybody to see because you're his.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus says, Satan, he's mine. She's mine and you cannot have them.
Amen.
So there's no smears. So praise the God. Let me finish this last sentence, I think.
Wow. Just let me say, appreciate it, brother.
Oh, my goodness. And your counselor, advocate for all the saints, that is the true blood of Jesus, born again, proclaiming faith believers. Now, I do a lot of talking about faith believers in this, which is also a Christian. Okay. Christ is the highest choice who resides in the holy third heaven. Praise the name of Jesus, 2 Corinthians 12:2-4. Upon your arrival into the third heaven, in the kingdom of God, when he returned, the Holy Spirit came down to us from the third heaven to seal the souls of true believers and followers. Luke 24:33-53, and Acts 1:2. And Jesus says, Satan, he's mine, she's mine, and you cannot have it. Amen to that.
Amen. That gives you, and should give all of you, a sense of peace, of a sense of strength, and a sense of knowing that you belong. You belong to Jesus Christ.
Amen.
You belong, wherever you are in this world, you belong. And we are eternal beings. This is our transition. We leave here, we go home. And
Amen.
Our home is where we want to keep our eyes and our focus on and our hearts on, is going home.
Don't focus on the smears. Focus on Jesus, who can take the smears away.
True. Now, I have to admit, sometimes I get up in the morning, look in the mirror, and I focus on the lack of hair. But that's just my vanity. That's why I wear the hat. You and I talked about this.
Yeah.
We are creatures. I don't say we're all vain creatures, but we are creatures of the flesh. And we want to see that this flesh that we hold so dearly, this mortal coil, never leaves. But God said he's going to make things all new.
Yes.
So whatever our problems are in this world, whether it's a lack of hair, or even too much hair, or just lack of knowledge, or whatever it is. All that's going to drop by the wayside, and we'll be past, and we won't even think about that anymore. It's worth keeping our hearts and our eyes on heaven.
Something you just said, we have flashbacks. Someone says something.
I have hot flashes.
But you said knowledge.
Knowledge.
When Jesus was walking the earth, teaching and preaching, healing the sick, people who had no ability to read, didn't have the written word in front of them and all, he just said, go and sin no more.
Yeah.
All they had, the only knowledge they had, they were standing in front of the Son of God,
mm-hmm.
and he spoke to them.
Right, and he spoke to the other ones they needed to hear.
That's all they had. They didn't have all the information that we have today.
Yeah, we have an abundance of wealth of knowledge to go by.
And they believe.
Yeah.
And that's why you cannot get to heaven through works.
Yeah.
It is through faith and faith only.
Yeah, amen.
We would be beating each other up to do a better work in order to get salvation if it was works for salvation.
We all fall short, but we're all redeemable, and we're all worthy of salvation.
Everyone.
Yeah.
Yes.
All right. So
that was good, Gary.
That's how we do this program, and we do invite you to go to our website if you haven't. You can get this on Amazon.com, you can get it through the website, or you can send me a notification through my Facebook page, and I'll get you a signed copy. Part of the proceeds are donated. I changed it from some of the local food banks to Tunnel to Tower Foundation to help Gold Star families. So that's where my book is, and why it's important to read it, because it does give you an insight to a man who went through life in a shallow existence, I think. Wasn't a bad person. I was more focused on just doing my job on television than worrying about what Gary Dean was inside. So, thanks to a lot of good friends that gave me a hand up, I'm still here today. So, hope you get a chance to read that. Joe?
And if you type into the search bar of Amazon, Dr. Joe Judkins, Judkins, it will pop you on my books. And when you review the books, what we talked about this morning is in the review section of the books, the first few pages. There is the link to my website that will put you to Gary's website, that will put you to the episodes of the videos. And so you can get whatever information you want about what we're doing.
Very good.
And I hope that in your way, you are doing the things that represent Jesus abiding in you, and you are abiding in Jesus Christ.
Big shout out to our producer, our technical director, and our good buddy, Mr. Shannon, who is taking care of all things technical and making sure that we get this on our webpage. We thank you for that, Shannon. We're going to have to
thanks, Shannon. Appreciate it.
give him a little plug for his for the Uber business as well.
Yeah.
Joe, that does it. I'm on my way to Kentucky and to go up and see my folks. I'm hoping I wasn't adopted, because Dad's 95 and Mom soon will be, and they're doing good. So I'm hoping I'm connected genetically to them. I'd like to have that longevity.
Well, good. I'm looking forward to it.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to seeing them too. So God bless you all. Come back and see us.
Take care.